So welcome. I'm the first one who opened it like the MVPs here. I was told to speak very slowly, and when I get excited, I will just turn off. So if I'm going too fast, let me know. Let me just know. So I'm not an Excel MVP anymore. I'm a data platform MVP. I used to be Excel MVP, but I do a little bit more on Power BI and all that kind of stuff. So I want to be back on the Excel team. So I said, what can I do? We'll do an Excel presentation now. So I'll do something about how I think you will make Excel models. This is something which is I invented it years ago. And it used to be 20, but I got 40 minutes. So I had to split it in the half. I take a half of all the things out of it. And I'm going to show you a little bit around. Well, that's the way it is. It's a bit, I hope so, a little bit, not too much. I need to have my glasses. The age is coming on. I cannot change that. So let's see if it works like this. Something like this. All right, here I go. Let's start with this. It's just simple Excel thing. I got some basic laws to talk with you. How is Excel working in large companies? Well, the main problem you have that there is a lot of things to find on the internet, on books, on the tooling of Excel. But there isn't much on how to create a normal file. So what you find is something what I call a cauliflower model, which starts with a little nice table in the somewhere, and then something happens over there, and you think, well, I want to have this one with it, and I put it over here, and let's take another sheet. So I got a lot of sheets, and I got all kinds of things everywhere. And what you want is something that, well, which is manageable. When you are working with it, and you can swear that the results are okay. I got some nice sheets working, and someone said, well, I put in something over here, and I got the result something over there, and if it works, well, I don't know, but you got your results. So what you want is that to have more impact on how you work. So the rules, the laws are made of how do I create a model that is functional, and I can swear that results are okay. So this is what I want to present to you today. And it's just an Excel over here. I got some modeling with it. I'm trying to talk about a little bit about it. Let's start with some things about what is really necessary to know about Excel. So I'll start with this one. This is just it. If you know that Excel is a calculation product, if you solve everything with a calculation, Excel will work for you. The thing you don't solve with a calculation, you're doing for Excel. That's simple. So, who of you is working for Excel? Everything is going automatically? For me, the best model is opening Excel. It will fetch everything, it will recalculate everything, and I got what I want to have. So doing that, I'll have to solve everything with a calculation. With the new tooling, you need to do one thing, refresh. And even that, I'll put in something like an automatically VBA which opened and refresh it, or put in refresh while opening. You know, doing nothing is the best thing you can do. Yeah, sure. So the next thing is, when I see when you work with Excel and you do something with Excel, you always see that people working from, that's what I want, and that's okay, because that's what you want, you know. So that's my dashboard. But what you see is they work in dashboards. They think in dashboards. You know, so I got a number over here, a number over there, and I put an auto sum under it, and I got what I want. And before you know it, everywhere things will go on. New dashboard, new calculations, new things, new other things. So within that, it's a bit of a problem to stay in control. So a dashboard is your final point. That's where you're going to. But try to think in calculations. If you think in calculations, you're not bound to your dashboard for your calculations. You have freedom of doing everything. Because, you know, the great thing about Excel, really what makes Excel great, is that the fact that you can do everything. You really can do everything in Excel. Sure, guy? Yeah, you know what the problem is with Excel? What the weakness is of Excel? You can do everything. So if you do everything again, you have the problem that you have you make to find structure in it, find things in it. So let's see what we have next. Next, yeah, well, if I'm going to be working with Excel, I distinguish two things. You have a designer, a builder, and you got a user. And those are two different roles you have in Excel. So let's see if I can find something to help with it. It's just a simple matter of things. If I look in this and I look at that thing, I look at this, he will return again, just a second. I got one thing over here. It's just one number, it's a million, you know? And when I'm a designer, I'm a builder, I'm looking at that number, and I say, well, 1 million, oh, that's in my budget, I can do something. When you work with Microsoft, that's the numbers you work with. So you say, okay, I can work with that. So it's just the number which is representing the business you're doing. If you're a designer builder, it could be a million, it could be 10,000, that doesn't matter. If I'm a builder, I want to be sure that the number which is standing there is correct, that the calculations which go to that number are the things you really can assure it's correct. That's a different position. You're looking at the number from your business, or you're looking at, I'm building it. How do I come to this number? In that case, in the normal ways of life, both roles are combined. You build your model, and you look at the number and you say, oh, it's okay, I can do with it. For me, those things I try to separate. If I'm building, I'm not interested in whether or not it's fitting in my budget. I'm interested, is the number correct? If I turn it around and I'm a user, then I look at the number and I say, oh, oops, bit too much. I think I need to refund it somewhere. Is it clear what I mean with it? Yeah? Right. I think I'll just, every breath I take, I'll hear over here. You hear everything, and I'm a heavy breather. I can't help it. All right, back to where we were in this thing. I'm not this sophisticated as you are. So, if you know that you're in control in building things, let's see if I do the correct thing like this, then you have some design options. I'm going to tell you today about the designing. How do I create a model? Not the one with the business side. Just all things are making in the role of building user. So if you design things, you start with an idea of a dashboard, something like it. And it doesn't matter whether you are working in Excel, whether you're working in Power Pivot, whether you're working in Power BI, it all starts with, what do I want to see? And at the moment you have that, you try to find the sources for it. Because I'm lazy, and I don't want to type all my numbers in it. So I'm going to find sources. That can be databases somewhere on the internet, it can be on your own company, doesn't matter where. It can be the Excel file from somebody else who typed it in. Yes, not me, you. So that's what you want to have. If you get your data in, there's something that you have to change to it. That can be done in Excel, that can be done in Power Query. Then you make your calculations, and then you come to your dashboard. And if you stick to that order, that's the way to develop things. If you have a dashboard and you want something added on it, then you start the same again. You got the same dashboard, you add something on it. You think, what do I want to add? What are my sources? What are my calculations? And how do I incorporate it in my dashboard? And that's the things you need to keep in mind when you build something. And when you build, you usually do something, well, oh, that's nice. Grab it, do something. Here it is. And I try to keep this line in mind. So that's the, let's say, the basic laws. Do I have some time left? A little. Not too fast? Yeah, okay. Questions, maybe? Not yet. All right. Okay, so the main thing you need to know is that Excel always works on ranges. Whoa. You can use a table, which is a range. And a range is always something which has a row and a column context. So let's start with that thing. What's a column context? Well, everybody, I think, will know it. It's something which is in a column. One of the main features of Excel, which I really like, but is really, really difficult to understand, is that normally a column has a data type. So we got all kinds of data types, two, according to Guy, text and numbers. But it's very important to keep it in mind. Excel is very forgiving with it. If I do something like, I type something like this, I could do it over here. Let's do it so over here. I do something like this. I need to get my glasses on. So one, and oh, that's a date column. Don't do it over there, Hank. Do it somewhere over here. So one, and 10, something like that. And if I use my auto sum somewhere over here, like this one, it will sum it, and it will say, oh, it's 2. So Excel is very good in finding out that the data type is not okay. I'm going too far away from the thing. I lost control. Yeah, right? I'm back again. So Excel, I'm going to decide much better. So Excel is very good in having, you know, if there's text within it, Excel doesn't mind. If you do it in Power Pivot, he will say, never do that again. Never do this. Power Pivot, he will never calculate it. So in Excel, it's very forgiving. The data types. And you got your row context. Do I need to say something about row context? No? Clear that the things in the row will belong to itself. You know, one of the nice features of Excel is that, for instance, you can sort column and don't sort your table, don't sort your range, which means that your row context will be out of the way. They say they change that behavior, so I'm very glad that now if you do it, it will change your whole table. But ranges is the way Excel works, and ranges are very, very strange things. And you need to know how ranges works with it. So I go to this one, and I should find something over here. So this is a range somewhere. It's about the same as you could see. And in Excel, there is one thing. If you use the shift key with the 8, the asterisk, then you select the range, whatever it is. And I'm not sure whether this will be the same in the Bulgarian version. You will take it there. So, but Excel knows the range, and you know it because the moment I do something like this, I go to my data tab, and I get something like that. Glasses is terrible. A filter. It shows the things on the upper row of my range. That means that Excel knows the range. Oh, the wrong side. Going to this one. So over here. Excel knows the range, knows to find the edges of it, and it works with it. So let's see how it works actually. If I do like something like this, and I add a little bit over here, so I'm hearing myself breathing. Guy, you don't want me back in the Excel. All right. I'll put something over here. Maybe outside. If I do the same tricks, I use the shift key and I use the asterisk, then you see it will expand itself. So Excel knows ranges by the fact that the top row that is empty and the row that is empty on the bottom, and the both columns at sides. So we find out automatically the range in which you work. So if you work in Excel and you work in ranges, you try to avoid things like this. If I do something like this and I put something over here, so they put one over here and two over there, something like this. If it's two, this is two. So if I'm going to sit over here and use the same trick, I let Excel find the range, then you'll see that the range will expand because the first empty row will now be the 8th and the 15th. So the first empty column, the G and the Q. So that will be nice, but if you look over here and I would do something like this and I changed, I had my active cell somewhere in this range, if I put it over here, you can see that Excel just have a very smaller range within it. So if you work in ranges in Excel, be aware that your range should be nice. Never do something like this. If you put comment to something you want to have, just add an empty column. And what I usually do if I want to have something only, I use in VBA, I use the current range often. So then I don't want to have my first line in it. I put a column within it and I say I hide the column and it looks like there are one range, but it isn't. And I can use my VBA very nice with it. In this way, if you work in ranges, you're much able to have more control. If I do something like this, which in my opinion is not quite allowed, but let's do it. Something like this. Just a second. Well, this is terrible. You have glasses all the time, but I can see in distance with it, and I can see close to it. So, oh, terrible, terrible, terrible. Something like this, and I do this one, something like this. You know? Why did I want to do this? I lost my line now. All right. I'll put an auto sum under it. Oh yeah, if I do it like this, this is what you normally see. They do something like total in front of it. So I got here something like total. The moment I do that, there, and I do another one. So I take the other range, the same range like this one, and I copy it and I paste it over here. This is a usual way of working. So this is, let's say, there's one department and there's another department, something like that. And if you do it in this way, you cannot analyze both things together. I cannot add the first A and the other A. So if I stay in ranges together, it's much more easier with a pivot table or some if to get my information as I want. Working in ranges in this way will means that there are two separate ranges, and Excel doesn't like to work with both things on the mind. The best thing you can do is to add something like this, get these lines out of it, make it one range, get this one out, and use something like a pivot table or some if, and then you're able to extract much more information than you have normally over here. So, ranges can be very large, can be very big. So it's not too difficult to make a very, very large range. So let's do something like this and get this one and copy it. And let's say, what would be an appropriate range, something like doing AC random number, something like this, shifts enter. So now I got a very large range. If you want to see how I did this trick, after you can ask me and I'll show you what I did. just easy getting a large range. Using this range, I can use the same things like this. I use the shift arrow to, and if I use the control and the asterisk key, And if you use the control and the dot, I will be pending on the corners of this range. And for me, that's very interesting because I always think in ranges. So I know I'm looking from the right top. Now I'm out of my range. That's not good. Hold on. Here. So I'm looking from my right, do I say yeah, right top to my left bottom. So twice control dot will bring, if I'm not with this one. Oh dear, always, why is this always popping up? Well, I don't want it. Do you have the same problem? Yeah, so something like this and something like this. So I twice tap control dot and I know the back, my stretch of my range. So let's continue, leave range as it is. Maybe it's a bit fast. We'll talk about ranges a bit later. So let's talk of something about calculations and inputs, something like this. One of the main things in Excel is I got two cells. And if you can read it, you know what it is. But one of the main problems in working with Excel is that you never know whether this is an input or a calculation. And it's a completely different things. So if I look over here and I'll activate this cell, you can see that within here, I always use the Excel triangle. I always look from what's in my cell, what's in my formula bar, and what's in my name bar. And with those three things, I just did something I shouldn't do. I unplugged something. All right, here we go. It's a good way. So looking at this, I know this is something somebody typed in. It's input. Going to this one, it's not an input. This is a calculation. And you can see it by here, that it's a calculation. It's a big difference. If I change this one into something like this, you can see that the reflection of this one will be recalculated over here. Without knowing whether it's a calculation or it's an input, I can change this one easily by changing it to another number. In that case, my link is broken, and changing this one means that the other one doesn't get updated. That means that there is a potential problem over here. And I always try to think in my input and my calculations in two separate ways. There are different things. You see the same, but they are different. And knowing that, it's easier to make models that are a bit more robust in knowing whether it's input or whether it's in calculation. Yeah? Questions? Obvious? No? Okay. Nice. Let's have it. So, I got some calculation rules. Let's do it correctly, something like this. So, whenever you're working in Excel, never, and I emphasize, never, ever combine input and calculations, because that will be killing you. Something like this. This is the amount of VAT you paid in the Netherlands, the tax, value-added taxes. If you use something like 21% on it, and it changes somewhere, I need to go to the formula to change it. And even worse, the moment I'm not on the cell, I cannot see what the tax rate is. So you don't want this. You either want the second one, because there's still the 21 is in it. So what you want to do is that you separate it in two different cells, and you combine the cells. Then you have your input on another level than your calculation. They are different cells. And the fact that you can change both insides, I should be able to change it. If my glasses are on, so if I change something like this, 200, you see that the number over here will change. If I want to do it in this one, I have to change the formula. And that's what you don't want to do. So be aware that you always want to be working in... be careful. I did it again. But now on the other side. Oh dear. I'm terrible with these kind of things. Better use names. I try to use names. I will come back to names a little bit later on, and I'll show you an example where I use names, all kinds of things. If you use names, it's more visible than a cell reference. And I use names to have all my ranges in one place. I have all my ranges in one place where I can adjust. Yep. And another thing, which says note 6 with it, formulas in one range should always be the same. Let's see if I can find it something. It has been changed in Excel lately, which I do appreciate very much. But let's see if I can find it here within my notes. I should have something like this. Yeah. So we had something like this. So I got my amount, I got my price, I got my totals, and I can just make a small calculation with does this one and multiplies it with my price. Something like this. And to be very honest, this is what you want to have. If I use a double click on my fill handle, it will drill down my formulas like this. Yeah, and the moment I look at it, hold on, I'm in the English version, not in the Dutch version. If I do it like this, you can see that the calculations will be going downwards. Which was an 8 will be a 9 will be a 10. If I copy it downwards. Everybody familiar with this thing? Don't have to explain it anymore with that. And you know the things like with this absolute references, and don't talk about that stuff. What you don't want is things like this. The moment I do this one and I do the outer sum again under it, over here, then the formula isn't in the same order. I got another formula over here, down here. So in the old days, when I just do these things like this, I could start with this one, just double click on it again, and then the last sum would be overridden. So it has stopped now, but one of the things I prefer not to do is getting what I call a formula breach in here. All my formulas will be the same, and my sum will not be there. And it's not in this time, even in this time, it's not the right precision. I got 3 lines now, that's not too much. But if I put it over here, and I'll take this one, and I put it over here, and I say this is my total, then I can have 1,000, 2,000, 4,000, 5,000 lines below it and still have my total over here. And my total will never be somewhere swirling down. And I don't get my formulas screwed up. So I try to keep my formulas in one range in the same order. Those are typical 2 different kinds of calculations. This is a row context calculation, and this is a column text calculation. Those are different. This is an aggregate. It will sum or do other things. This is always the same on the row level. If you recognize the 2 different things, you're going to work more and more in ranges. This is a separate range. Yeah? Questions? Not yet. All right. I'm doing fine, I think. Going back to where I was. What? Not yet? Questions? Right here. Now let's see. What I tend to do is that I use separate places for separate functions. I try to find positions in my Excel model where I... Oh, is that boring? No, no mind. I try to find positions in my modeling where I store my things. So if I got my input, I put input sheets. Input is always separate from all other kinds of things. I got calculation sheets. I got output sheets. I got variable sheets, SISFA sheets. But I also got other things, you know. I got ranges, and I tend to keep my, have all my ranges in names. And I do transformations, and I use Power Query for it. So all the things I do, I like to find places where I can store my things so that it's much more efficient to look at things. So let's see if I can give you an example of it, which it's very old. It's this. I hope you can see it a little bit. I hope I can make it a bit. Can you see it a little bit? Yeah, okay. It's just all kinds of control things. And if I use this one, you can see that if it's ready with calculation, that it will change everything. Did it change? Not yet. Still waking. Calculation, calculate, calculate, calculate. All right. This is you can see here a little bit of calculation. So let's talk a little bit before it's there it goes. It changed everything. And if I want to have 1 year not within it, I click that year on, and that year will be out of everything. This one is a better year because there was nothing there. So this is a example which I was built for a Belgium firm which control water supplies in Belgium. And it used to be three models for about 100 MB each. And they didn't run anymore. Some way or the other, Excel said, it's a bit too much for me. So this is one model. I have everything here. And I build it with my building principles. And I, as you can see down here, I have a couple of sheets colorized with the things they are. I got two calculation sheets. It's in Dutch, so I'll translate it a little bit. My tables are my input, and I got three kinds of input. I got a table for which is the cities. I got a table which are the water companies, and an in-between table which combines those. I got two tabs which calculates my tables and which calculates this one. And I got a couple of variable and var sheets. And what you're looking now is the output. And I try to build everything in a way that is as less as possible. So all my tables are here. And they're a bit messed up because the user here always tends to color things. For me, it's important to show that whatever is in this orange color, the standard input color, standard input color here, is what you can change. You actually need to change that. And those columns, I need to have to fill in things, but you cannot change it. There's not any protection on this sheet, not at all. As you look at it in your review, there is no protection, as you can see. But I use matrix, and I cannot change anything in this section. Using this way of building, I'm very efficient in collecting my data. So within this, and I got my in-between tables, and I got my tables of the water companies, I can build this one. And I use this tab. Do I use the use one? Yes, this one, to build it. And using this, I got all my calculations in this sheet. And this is a rather large sheet. So everything you will look and find, which needs to calculate it, will be found over in. And they've all been placed in each separate ranges. And all ranges works together with each other. I use names, and I think I will be a little bit later back on the names here. Because if I use names, I know where my ranges are, and I can track my names back to my source. So I can find the chain of calculations which reflects to your imports again. Something like that. So using sheets for the separate for separate functionality, for me, is a key to work in Excel. Let's see, where were I? Boink. Here. No questions left? How much time do I have left? All right, go on. Here we are. I use names. Who is familiar with the name function in Excel? Ooh, that's nice. For those who aren't, I'll show you a little example of what names are. In the notes over here, I use this one because number 7, something like this. So if I'll start over here, it's much easier, much better. If I'm working with this kind of things, you know, I work with a list like this, it's easier for me if I look at the formula here, this one, then the formula is quite easy because you're next to it. But you can, that boring, Charles. if it's a very long sheet name and it's somewhere far away, it's very hard to track it. So I use names to track things. And names are very, very easy, and it's one of the things, one of the functionalities in Excel which is not that commonly used. And I cannot work without it. It's one of the basic things for me to work in Excel. And well, let's have a try. So if I do something like this, boink, and I get this rid of this stuff over here, something like it. So the first thing I do is make an analysis of how much data I do expect. I can use those three numbers, but maybe I want to add a little bit more. So say I want to add something like 10 rows. So that would be this amount. If I look in the name over here, I see I got 10 rows, one column. So I got 10 rows, two columns using this. And I use the thing over here. Oh, hold on. This one. And I use cell style and use this import. For me, cell styles are very important. I must say I do not like the colorizing of it, but they're very helpful to understand what is my input and what is my calculation. So I use it very much over here. And say that I will call this one, this section over here, and I give it a name. And I start with, always with, which is it? For me, this is a list, so I start with LST. And then I give it a name, say list amount, something like this, using the enter key, and my name is set. I cannot use a cell reference because then I will go to that cell, and I cannot use a space. You can use an underscore, I use capitals for it. But if you have that, and you're somewhere over here, so let's say I'm over here, and I was think, all right, that name, that list, what was in that list? I know I got the name list amount, so I'll use this little triangle over here, click on it, get my list amount, and doopies, I'm there. So I use that to go to where I want to be. And if I take this one over here, and I make this something like list, hold on, just type it right, price. enter. Yes, that's it. I got both. As you can see, I got both. So if I want the amount with the price, I select the complete range next to it. I use this F3, which gives me my page name. I paste my amount. I use the asterisk to make the calculation, F3 again, and use my list price. I cannot use enter now. If I use enter, in the new ways, it will be fine, because then enter will be the same as making a matrix of it. I use control shift enter, and I got it everywhere. And at the moment I'm here, and I add something, 10, still nothing, it will just do that. So what I'm doing, if I want to make a good Excel model, one of the things I do, I always make a data analysis. How much data do I expect? I make all my calculations on that range, and the moment something happens, something needs to be adjusted, it will be already be pre-calculated, it will all be there. So in my normal way of working, I will never ever touch my calculations. If my calculations are correct, I can be assure you that the result will be okay. I never ever find Excel making a mistake in calculations. If there are mistakes, they are coming from human interference. So if my formulas are okay, I can assure you that the results are okay, except for the part of the human interaction. So for me, this kind of stuff is very important, thinking about having a more than one line. If you saw the model just a little bit before, and you look at the input over here, and you could see that this kind of input over, let's have this one, I think. See if I can find someone with a little bit more. Here you see this one has already space for input to 2015. This is an old model. It's out of working now. It's replaced by a Power Pivot model at this moment. But it's at this time, it was built in 2008, and it was built for 2015. And everything until that date will be put in. So that's the data analysis. And the next year they want to do something, they just put in the import, and everything will work fine. No problem at all. So that's a bit of how to work in Excel my ways. What else do I have here? This one, yeah. Questions. One of our fellow MVPs, Jan Karel Pietersen, has a name manager, which is much better than the Excel. Oh, sorry, Kai. Much better than a little bit better than the Excel manager. But I'm not using it here. The standard things of Microsoft is doing very good for me. Let's say that too. You have a little bit more options with the Jan Karel Pietersen name manager, but it's not always possible to install it. It's an add-in, and not all companies allow you to use add-ins. The standard thing will work. Will work fine. Sorry, Guy. Huh. Don't make it next year again. Okay, so what I like to do is I'm looking for security again. So looking at things like that, I use matrix to guarantee a bit more control over your outputs. I used it a little bit before in calculations, but I also use it in my outputs. So if I'm going to do something like this, I go to this one over here. What do you say? So let's do something over here. Where notes here. This one. So this is basically what I want to show. Maybe I want to adjust my formula a bit. I can adjust this one a bit because it's a matrix. Huh? So I can say something like an if with it. So if
something like this, and then I like to use this one, something like over here. So this is over. That's not my logical test. That's not my. That's when it's true. Or false, something like it. Control X, Control V, put it over. My logical test will be if F3, my list amount, is empty. Two double quotes to it. And that means if it's empty. And if it's empty, I don't want to see anything. Otherwise, I want to see the calculation. Why do I do this? Because if I just switch this a little bit around over here, I don't want to see the zeros over here. So what I'm saying in this formula, if this one is empty, forget this one. Don't show anything. So using this one, I get something like this. Now this is my range. It's a stretched range. And if I give this range a name and I need to change a little bit, I use the control shift asterisk to get my complete range with my headers with it. And I give it a name. It's a table. A table for me is something which has rows and columns. And I say it's table output. Something like it. Enter, this is it. And I want to know how large this one is. So I hit the shift key, one down, one up. And if you look in the name box, you can see it's 11 rows and 3 columns. And as long as I keep my finger on the shift key, you will see this information. And I need the same amount of space cells in my output. So if we go to my output over here, and I select, what was it? 11 to 3, yeah? Something like this. F3. And I got my table output over here. And I enter it as a matrix. You will see this. You got your zeros already, because, yes. Oh, we got 5 minutes left. Oops. Fasten it up. The moment I change something over here, that was over here, I think so, and I add something, like say 2 or 3 and 3, it will be in my output already be there. So I use this kind of things, and I try to avoid this kind of zeros. Of course, in my output I did. Let's see, where were we? What did I have? Oh dear, going fast. Well, that's what we talk about. Be aware, make something. What I do in companies, I talk in companies and I say, try to make in your company the same way of making up cell styles. If you use the same cell style within your company, if somebody else opens your model of their cooperating, they see immediately on the fact how it is formatted, what kind of thing it is. And that's what I think is very important. I do try to find out in companies a couple of those things. If you work in companies, try to make company rules of how do we do calculations? What do we allow? What do we don't allow? Then if somebody goes away, somebody else can read it and can use it again. It's very important that there is common sense of how to build the things the same. That doesn't mean you don't have the flexibility, but you can still do everything in Excel, but it has more a way that the company knows what you're doing. So, next 5 minutes. Yeah, well, this is one of the things I'm very fond of. Don't have ever redundancy. What you never really want is if you see some things like you have all kinds of sheets, you know, and for every month one sheet. I don't have it, I got one sheet and I can select my month and it fill full in. But if you have several sheets with all, say, month ideas, I really don't want to have something like this. Time is on my is not on my side this moment. So if I'm over here and I have my year something like this and it's next year or something, so this will be this and a now. Of course, this is an input, you know. I want to know that it's input, and I'll give it a name. It's a var because it's one thing, var year. So what I don't want is that in my output there is something like 2018 over here, because then I got two places with the same information. So I use a link, or in this case I use the name F3, and I say code my var here, and then get it over here, mark this in a style that everybody knows that it's not input, but it's more something like a calculation. Yes, I need to stop somewhere. So there's a calculation over here. This is not the nicest one. And there's one place where I change my year, and then I'll be sure that everywhere else it will be done. So I'll find the variables and the sys variables. The variables are things that our users are allowed to change. And system variables are the variables I need to have to work my model. So that will be the place where I store the information from a Dropbox or something like that. That's in sysvar, and that's a sheet I hide at the end. But in variable, the user can change something, and I just want to be sure that there's that place I change the year, and everywhere in the model where the year will become, it will be changed. All right, I got 1 minute left, I think. So if there are questions, what's the last one? Yeah, well, I'm not going into this one. I'll leave that to another one. One of the things you always have is garbage in, garbage out. And one of the things I really thank you very much, Microsoft, for adding it. Power Query, the new kid on the block, be aware. That saves so much time if you can use Power Query. For me, that's the invention of this age, next to Power Pivot. First Power Pivot, then Power Query. But Power Query will change, and Ken knows everything about Power Query. So be, if you have questions, I redirect now. So that was what I'm going to present. I will give you this at the end. I'll give you that at the end. Yeah, all right. So that was it. I hope it was not too much of a chaotic thing. I hope you find out things. If you have questions, please give them. Not yet. Want to see a little bit more? We can do something in breaks in between. You can ask me everything. Thank you very much.